195, number 195. Let us stand, we'll sing together. Down at the cross where my Savior died, down where for cleansing my sin I cried, there to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name, glory to His name, glory to His name, there to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name. Be seated, the choir singing Sweeter as the Days Go By.
Thank you. choir. Let's all stand together, try and greet someone. Teenagers, you may come up as soon as the adult choir gets down. Thank you so much for being here tonight, and let's be much in prayer for Ronnie Grantham and his family. He's in the hospital. I haven't gotten an update. Has anybody heard anything in the last hour? Okay, so he's in heart failure. Yes, ma'am. Send him home. Let me just tell y'all right now, if I'm ever in heart failure, don't send me home. I'm teasing, I know. I understand it's nothing, but don't send me home if I'm in heart failure, okay? All right, let's be much in prayer for Brother Ronnie then, and lift him up in prayer. I have just a few announcements, and then we're going to hear from the teen choir. No Sunday school teachers meeting tonight after the service. There will be a bus workers meeting for the children's routes only in the Christian workers classroom. The pastor and his Mighty Men conference, if you've not, we still have a few spots available for that. I know we've shaved back the room, Brother Frederick, some of the rooms. We may still have a spot or two if you're interested in going. The cost is $30 per person, and they'll feed you good at the conference, and we'll have to provide, I think, one meal in the evening time, and any snacks you want coming back. But always an enjoyable time, gentlemen, and so I would encourage you to come if you possibly can. And then we'll be leaving at 3 o'clock, by the way, on Friday. So 3 o'clock on Friday, we'll be leaving. If you have other arrangements than that, please see me and let me know what those are. Saturday morning visitation at 10 a.m. And then baby shower, girl, for Adam and Kristen Hootie, Sunday, February the 5th. This coming up Sunday, 5 to 5:45 in the Fellowship Hall. And Sunday night is a deadline for Freedom Kids to answer the pastor's question. And the box is located in the vestibule. And in case anybody wondered, we'll not be canceling service not this Sunday, but the next Sunday on the 12th. All right. In case you wondered or ever figured it, we're not canceling service on the Super Bowl Sunday. All right. Amen. And we won't be having the wings and the ranch in the auditorium. I can promise you that. Amen. Maybe at my house, but not in here. Amen. All right. But thank you so much for being here, visitors. Thank you so much for coming. And we're going to hear from the teen choir. And my wife and I are going to go preach to the kids, Brother Frederick. So you got the service from here on out. And we're going to go bother the kids a little bit. So, and anyway, Brother Frederick's going to be preaching. And my wife, you got to play a special, don't you? Yes. Well, okay. Well, she'll be coming after the special then. Amen. And thank you so much for being here. Let's hear the teen choir gladly.
I brag about, look what he's done for me.
He took away my broken heart, replaced it with a smile. He took away all my sins, and he made me his child. Wipe the teardrops from my eyes, so I can clearly see. Is it any wonder why I brag of him? Look what he's done for me. He took away my broken heart, replaced it with a smile. He took away all my sins, and he made me his child. Wipe the teardrops from my eyes, so I can clearly see. Is it any wonder why I brag of him? Look what he's done for me. Is it any wonder why I love him so? Look what he's done for me.
When I woke up this morning, your presence filled the room. With a grateful heart, I just shook my head as I bowed in awe of you. Lord, you have been so faithful, so loving, kind, and true. And every morning, your mercies are new. What you've done for me, and my mind cannot grasp the depths of your generosity. The riches of your mercies, the wonders of your ways, and my voice cries out in endless praise.
You have been good.
Better life.
That was a blessing. We'll have the fellas come forward and get ready for our offering. And Sunday school teachers with the bus workers meeting, we're sharing the same room, so that's why we're giving it up to them to have their meeting tonight. But if you do have any concerns or questions, you can see me right after the service. If you have a need for your class, please be sure to do that. Or if you miss me tonight, you can contact the church office. Ms. Carla will let me know as well. That was a blessing. I'll also say this, teenagers, the sheet is in the vestibule for our activity on Saturday, February 11th. We're going to the pit. That's the go-kart, laser tag, putt-putt, that old thing. And so $15 per person. If you can sign up, and we'll start to collect money on Wednesday night, and we'll get that turned into the church office as well, okay? Well, let's be faithful to give, and we'll ask David White. Great job singing, by the way. Good job on that. I'm glad all the work I've been doing with you has been paying off, so that's a blessing. Me staying away from our kids makes them sing better. That's what I'm doing. So, David, why don't you lead us in prayer, please?
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for all you've done for us. I pray you to bless tonight, bless the service. I pray you fill both the clamp, your power and your strength. I pray you bless this offering, bless the gifts and the giver. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And take your Bibles, turn to the book of Genesis. That's where we'll be in chapter 39. Preacher's gone, so ushers, go ahead and bring those buffalo wings and ranch. And no, I'm teasing. Oh, Mrs. White's still here. Sorry, don't tell him. I was just joking. It was a joke. And we'll be in Genesis chapter 39. We'll give an introduction to lay the foundation for the message and get right into it. Hope it'll be a blessing to you. And let's have a word of prayer. But we'll be in Genesis 39. If you want to turn or just put something in James chapter 1, you can do that as well. We'll go back and forth a little bit, but we'll primarily be in Genesis 39 this evening. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for the midweek service. And as good as Sunday was, and for many who've had their devotions on a daily basis, this is kind of an oasis in the middle of the week. And so I pray you would meet with us, that you'd speak to us through your Bible, and thank you for speaking to us in song already. Pray you be with the services going on here and with our Freedom Youth Club. Thank you for our nursery workers and their diligence to be a part of that. And so, Lord, we ask that you meet with us. Bless Tabitha as she sings and the remainder of the service. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Bothered by the journey, thought of weary miles ahead, wished I could go to heaven on an easy path instead. Found my mind all full of wishes till the Spirit tenderly spoke to me of others toiling. Then the tears came silently. Could I wish for me a palace here on earth below, while some who are called to missions If I'm a soldier of an army whose captain hung on a tree, how could I wish some easy life for me? Could I wish for me a palace here on earth below, while some who are called to missions suffer more than glad to? For fame and fortune, what a claim to call my own, while some who are far more worthy bear the cross unknown. If I'm a soldier of an army whose captain hung on a tree, how could I wish some easy
for that, Tabitha and Miss Jennifer, for playing. Ashlyn, good job during the offertory. Genesis chapter 39, and I think we'll do two things. Timothy, come up here first for a second, my son, and I want to show something. We're going to talk about Joseph here just for a second by way of introduction. There's many things in the life of Joseph, but one of the things most notably, it's probably David and Goliath and Joseph are probably stories we've heard from children, Sunday school classes, and we're probably most familiar with it. Anybody know something that you just immediately associate with Joseph off the top of your head? Any takers on this? Yes, ma'am? Oh, thank you, Miss Pat. Very good. And I thought the same thing. Now, I don't know if this is a coat with colors. I don't know if it has many colors, but that's one of the things you associate with Joseph, is a coat of many colors. Okay, I can't confirm that this is something that he would wear, but we know the story, how out of all the brothers, he was favored more than the rest, and his dad showed an affinity and love for him and gave them this coat of many colors. And what a cherished item. But what did the other brothers do when they saw him get that coat? Right? So I'm going to speak about Joseph's coat, but this evening I want to speak about a different coat. You remember they ripped this coat off of him. They killed an animal and sprinkled its blood on it. They put him in a pit. Then they sold him to the Midianites, and they came back to their daddy and said, oh my goodness. And you never really hear much about this coat until Donny Osmond went on stage and started to perform Joseph in the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat. But in the Bible, that's the least you hear of it. There's many types of Christ in the life of Joseph. Jesus came into his own, and his own received him not. Joseph came into his brethren, his own, and they received him not. And there's several more we can go into, but look at Genesis 39. I want to talk about another coat here tonight. In a familiar passage here, verse number 1, and Joseph was brought down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, captain of the guard, an Egyptian, brought him of the hands of the Ishmaelites, and which had brought him down thither. And the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a prosperous man, and he was in the house of his master the Egyptian. And his master saw that the Lord was with him, and the Lord made all that he did to prosper in his hand. And Joseph found grace in the sight, and he served him, and he made him an overseer of his house, and all that he had put into his hand. And it came to pass that at that time that he had made him overseer of the house and over all that he had. And the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake, and the blessing of the Lord was upon all that he had in the house. Now, we'll continue to read in verse 6 in a second. But now Joseph has a new coat. Joseph is working for Potiphar, who's a very substantial and I'm sure powerful man in the kingdom there. And so it's a little different. It's a little more royal looking, being in the palace in a nice house. And I know those sleeves are a little bit long, but Joseph was taller than my son. And so maybe it's a different coat. Now let's continue reading in verse 5. And it came to pass that from that time he had made him overseer in the house and over all that he had. And the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake. Verse 6. And he left all that he had in Joseph's hand, and he knew not aught he had, save the bread which he did eat. And Joseph was a godly person, a goodly person, and well favored. And it came to pass after these things that his master's wife cast his eyes upon Joseph. And she said, lie with me. But he refused and said unto his master's wife, behold, my master wotteth not what is with me in the house, and he hath committed all that he hath to my hand. There is none greater in this house than I, neither hath he kept back anything from me but thee, because thou art his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? And it came to pass, as she spake to Joseph day by day, every day, that he hearkened not unto her to lie by her or to be with her. And it came to pass about this time that Joseph went into the house to do his business, and there was none of the men of the house there within. And she caught him by his garment, saying, lie with me. And he left his garment in her hand and fled and got him out. So now as he's serving, Potiphar's wife comes to him, says, lie with me. And day by day, she keeps tempting her and requesting of this. And it got to the point to where when she grabbed him, Joseph says, no way, I'm out of here. And as she was trying to pull him back and get after him, he took off and just got out of the house. What a sermon this coat depicts. And we've heard statements like this before. She took his coat, but not his character. Though she slandered him and falsely accused him, and he was later thrown in the prison and left there, that coat is what I want to talk about tonight. Joseph's other coat. Joseph's other coat, I'm speaking on this topic, overcoming temptation. That's what that coat preaches to me, is overcoming temptation. And so let's see a few things real quickly. We'll examine three thoughts about temptation this evening to help us see this. And number one, notice that he was not exempt from temptation because of his spiritual position. Not his physical position, being in command at Potiphar's house, not because of his promotion to that job and being there, but even because of his spiritual position, none of us are void of temptation. If you've been saved 60 years or more, you're not void of temptation. If you've been saved 50 years, 40 years, 30 years, if you've been saved a year, if you've been saved 6 months, 6 weeks, or 6 days, none of us are exempt from temptation. It comes to all of us. So Joseph, he was righteous. He was faithful to God. Look at verse number 9, what he says. There is none greater in this house than I, neither hath he kept anything back from me, because thou art his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? He didn't want to succumb to the temptation, not because he knew it wasn't right against her or against Potiphar, but because it was wrong against God. It's not looking over his shoulder to see who's there. He was looking up saying, God sees everything. I can't do this. Notice that he was not exempt from temptation because of his spiritual position. But secondly, with this, temptation comes to everyone. Secondly, with this, he did overcome the temptation because of his spiritual position. So we're not exempt from it. Once you say, I trust you as my personal Savior, and I'm not doing anything I can, I'm not trusting anything I can do to get to heaven. I'm trusting your death, your burial, your resurrection. Take me to heaven when I die in Jesus' name. Amen. From that day forward, there's a target on you. And you are ample and you are able to be tempted. But he did overcome the temptation. He wouldn't have survived this temptation had he not been a faithful Christian. And that was his spiritual position. He walked with God, and because of that, he was able to overcome the temptation. Those who walk beside temptation thinking they can control it in every situation are just kidding themselves. So what does God say about temptation? So obviously we see that temptation comes everywhere. What does God say about temptation? Are you in James now? Let's flip over to James chapter 1. Let's try to understand these things real quick about temptation. James chapter 1, verse 13 through 15. I want us to understand this as we look at these verses. If you want to put these in your margins to be reminders of you when Satan tries to tell you otherwise, or you may read something on Facebook that doesn't go along with what the Bible says, let's make sure we know what the Bible says. First of all, temptation is not of God. It's not of God. He gives us trials and he gives us testing, but the temptations are not of God. Follow along here. Verse 13. Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God, for God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. Oh, okay, I got it. So then Satan does it. Not necessarily. Watch this. Look at verse 14. Temptation is brought by man's lust. Verse 14, but every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own devil, lust. So temptation's not of God. Temptation's brought by man's lust. Look at verse 15. We see where it's conceived and how it grows and what it brings. Then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth, what's the next word there, class? Sin. And then look what sin brings with it. And when it is finished, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. Now here's what I want us to understand real quickly is, though God is a just God and a righteous God, and in the Old Testament there were a few occasions of this, he does not do this when we fall to temptation. He doesn't kill us. And people can argue that and say, well, I guess the Bible's not there. Unless you understand what death really is, death is not just the cessation of life. Death is also separation from life. When I'm laying in a casket someday and I'm there, I will no longer be living the cessation of life, but I will be separated from this life and I'll be up in heaven. And too many times I've seen in our Christians today that they may not have a cessation of life, but they have a separation of life. They're the most miserable people on planet Earth, Christians who keep falling and falling and falling and falling into the temptation. You start to wonder their own value, start to wonder their own worth. And it's because they've succumbed to this temptation, which is brought about by their lust, which then helps them to sin, and sin, when it is finished, bringing forth death. And these are where these thoughts come in. Well, I'm too dirty to go to church. Why even read the Bible? I'm just going to mess up again tomorrow. Pray? It's probably just going to bounce off the ceiling. Now, those are not true statements, but they're statements made by people who keep on falling to temptation. They start wondering, every time they see a group talking, they're probably talking about me and what I did. They're probably talking about what I'm going to do tomorrow when I fall to this as well. Temptation comes to us all. Temptation does not come from the Lord, though he does allow temptation to come. Prime example is Job, right? Satan said, can I throw some temptations at him and put some lustful things in his mind to start to go to sin? And God says, oh, hast thou considered my servant Job? Go for it. I wonder if he'd say that about Clint Fredericks. Hey, I was going to go to Rule Hall and work on Clint Fredericks. I wonder if God would go, can you wait till next week? I want to work on Sam Hopkins. I want to work on Kenny Vass. I want to work on would God be going, yeah, go ahead. Temptation comes to all of us. Second thing, not only does temptation come to all of us, let's look and see how did Joseph handle temptation? How did Joseph handle the temptation? Because obviously we admire him for getting it. So what can we learn from Joseph maybe to apply to our lives? Well, again, number one, he left the scene of temptation. Look at verse number 12. And she caught him by his garment, saying, lie with me. And he left. He got out of there. He said, I'm gone. And he didn't hang around to prove that he's man enough to get through this tough time. He says, I got to get out of here. The temptation's too much. I'm gone. Not only did he leave the scene of temptation, but he was spiritually prepared. Remember, we said it was his spiritual position that allowed him to overcome this. Look at verse number 3. The Bible says, and his master saw that the Lord was with him. The Lord, he just kind of looked at him and said, there's something special about this guy. Well, the Lord's with him. His heart was in tune with God. He knew what sin was. He recognized sin when it came to him. I'm baffled when I deal with individuals who succumb to temptation, how ignorant they become. I didn't know that was, you got to be kidding me. Are you serious? I didn't realize. You're either lying or you're not in tune with God to where you would think succumbing to do this temptation to perform this act of sin is something that would not bother God. So either you're lying to me or you do not have a strong relationship with God enough to know what he likes and does not like. Right? I'm grateful that now going on 6 years as Preacher White's assistant pastor, I know questions to ask him and I know questions I don't need to ask him because I already know the answer. Right? How does that happen? With relationship, with fellowship. And so for us to go, I didn't know God doesn't like cussing. I didn't know God doesn't want me hanging out at that bar. I mean, I thought maybe I could be a witness to him. Really, where's your tracks? I forgot them, but you know, maybe, blah, 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 blah. It's amazing. Temptation. What does, his solution is the same solution that can be for us when we're tempted. Listen carefully. We need to leave the scene whenever we're tempted. Whatever vice it is. Now, I'm not saying our whole church is dealing with a woman trying to entice us and go, here, listen, I'm talking about temptations of many things. We'll get to those in a second. But any type of temptation that you seem to succumb to, leave the scene. Amen. If you're still on your 2017 diet, good for you, but don't go to the 75-foot buffet. Right? Don't stand in line at K&W unless you're just getting your veggies or whatever. But, is that okay? I mean, let's think about it. Yeah, I got the patch on. I'm trying to get off smoking, so I'm going to go hang out in the break area with all the guys at work. I'm not smoking it. Leave. Get out of there. So that's what we learned from Joseph, is to leave the scene. Then secondly, be spiritually prepared for the temptation. Now, let's back up to our first point. We said temptation comes to everybody, so it's going to come. So you know what we better do? We better get ready for it. Well, maybe he'll skip me tomorrow. I wouldn't count on it. I use this phrase in Sunday school, Brother Roy. You'd be proud of me. I said, you know, we ought to be loaded for bear even if we just get squirrel. And some of the guys in my class went, what have you done with my Sunday school teacher, Clint Fredericks, right? But why do we use that term for hunting and all these other things when really I'd rather be loaded for bear for the bear attack of Satan when the temptation is revealed in front of me. I'd rather be loaded for bear and have Monday off. But I'm going to get ready for, because Tuesday's coming. And I can't just rely on what my preparations were for Monday. I got to get ready for Tuesday, and I got to get ready for Wednesday, and I got to get ready for every day. Once again, I faced Satan this morning, and I battled him all the day long. What? But the sun's coming up in the morning. Amen. Be spiritually prepared. Be spiritually prepared. James 4:7, submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. The resisting of the devil and the fleeing of the devil comes when we totally submit. Submit yourselves, therefore, unto God. Now, because you've submitted, you can resist the devil, and he will now flee from you. But if you're not spiritually prepared, and if you're not submitting, you're going to be a statistic. You'll be a sermon illustration. Submit. James 4:8, draw nigh to God and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. 1 Corinthians 10:13, there hath no temptation taken you but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you or allow you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way of escape, that ye may be able to bear it. Romans 13:14 says, but put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof. 2 Peter 2:9, the Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptations and to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. Just before the moment of yielding to temptation, God always provides a way of escape if you're spiritually prepared. If you're not spiritually prepared, you're not ready. You're going to fall. So let's lastly close this up by saying this. We said, first of all, temptation comes to everybody. Secondly, we said, how did Joseph handle temptation? But here's that $64,000 question. Why does God allow us to be tempted? Why is he having me go through this test? Why me? Here we go again. Man, I got to go to the hospital again. Man, we got to go see the doctor again. Man, we got to take our car into the shop again. Man, we got to, and it just seems that you're always going, okay, all right, fine, preacher preaches. This is a test from God. I'm supposed to overcome it. But why me? Why not my next door neighbor? Why not those people who sit four pews ahead of me who never shake my hand during handshaking time? Why not them? God's purpose for us as Christians is to develop and to grow. But grow in grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. As newborn babes, we do desire the sincere milk of the word, but at some point we got to get off the milk and start eating some meat. And so God puts us through some trials and some allows us to be tempted so we can grow up and be the Christians he wants us to be. The threat of temptation should keep us. Several things. I'm going to see if this works here. Fellas, I'm going to try to stand over here and play a sound from my phone. Let's see if this works. I'm going to put this up to this. You want to try that, Mark? And we'll see if this has any noise here. See if this sound means anything to anybody here. Does that sound mean anything to anybody here other than me? Uh-oh, I can't turn it off. There we go. To me, every time I hear that sound, Brother Roy, I think I'm 8, 9, 10 years old, and I'm in Hawaii. On the first of every month, and I used to live there in the summer times as a kid, on the first of every month, around noon, you'd hear that sound. They're testing the island air raid sirens to make sure they work. And they've done it on the first of every month since 1941. What is it supposed to remind the people about? It reminds them, if you hear that sound, remember the last time that happened? Wasn't real good. Now, thankfully, we've not had to hear that on the islands and because of that same reason, but they do use those sirens when the tsunami warnings come to Hawaii. But as a kid, I would hear that. And can I just say this? The threat of temptation should get us to sound the alarm in our mind. To know that there's a threat out there, it should sound the alarm that we need to make sure. Hey, you know what? When my wife and I walk to the car after church, we just walk next to each other. I don't know why, but last week, I think I grabbed your hand, didn't I? We just walked, held hands right there. We were walking back to the car. I was like, let's walk back again. Yeah. But normally, I know we're just walking, you know. But if we go to some place and there's a big group, just a horde of people, I'll grab her arm and just bring her close. Sometimes I'll put her in front of me and I'll just kind of, or sometimes I'll put her behind me, and depending on how the group goes, I want to make sure they're close nearby because I'm sensing it's probably not the best, right? So we have the logic to do that. We have the logic to lock the doors at night. or just make sure it's loaded by the bed at night, or whatever you do to make sure everything. Yet when we go about our spiritual lives, we don't do the same thing. The temptations come, and it better make sure, it should keep us, if we know temptation's a threat, that we live on high alert. I don't know if every morning you just need to play an air raid signal to just make you, oh, that's right, today's the day Satan could try to send temptation to me. It's also not just the threat of temptation should keep us living on high alert. The threat of temptation should keep us depending on prayer. God, I need you. I need you to surround me. I need you to keep my eyes right, my ears right, my mouth right, keep my thoughts right, keep my heart right. God, I don't want it here, so if I don't want it here, I don't need it here. And if I don't need it here, it's going to come in either here or here. So God, keep it away. Help me to do my part, to turn away, to look away, to turn it off, shut it off, turn it down. Da-da-da. God, I want to make sure. Prayer. The threat of temptation should keep us living on high alert, depending on prayer, should keep us living in the Word of God. Thy word have I hid in mine heart, that I might not sin against God. If I'm not going to sin, that means I'm going to avoid the lust. If I'm going to avoid the lust, I'm going to avoid the temptation. How? Thy word have I hid in mine heart. Not just those seven verses you learned as a kid either. New verses. Start to learn new verses this year. Every week, try to one verse. And then thirdly, how about fellowship with, or lastly, fellowship with Christ. If the threat of temptation is here, it should keep us living on high alert, depending on prayer, living in the Word of God, and fellowshipping with Christ. 1 Peter 4:12 says this, Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened unto you. Oh my goodness, I got tempted today. Oh my goodness, a trial came. What? No, God says, that's right, it's time to grow up. I want you to go through this temptation. Temptation should strengthen us. Temptation should draw us closer to God. Temptation should cleanse us. Temptation, ultimately, if we don't fall to it, will reward us. James 1:12 said, Blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him. That almost makes me want to say, bring it on. I want to get a victory. As competitive as some people are in this church, this should almost challenge you to say, bring it on. Because with God's help, I'm going to overcome this. Now, if you're going to say, bring it on so I can do it, watch out. Take heed lest you fall. The Discipleship Journal did a survey of thousands of Christians on this topic of temptation. Here's some of the results I thought were interesting. The survey respondents noted that temptations were more potent. I mean, they really felt it hitting up against them. They really felt it come. 81% said that it was more potent after they neglected their time with God for that day. 8 out of 10 people said, when I skip spending time with the Lord, that's when the biggest ones came. 57% said when they were tired, that's when it came. 51% said when they were stressed, that's when it came. And 49% said when they were going through a difficult time. I think that goes with stress, but it says that's when the temptation came and hit them. It was most potent at that time. So what temptation are we talking about? I don't know. What are you dealing with? I just sat on my desk and wrote, I was just trying to go through the alphabet, but then it just got so long. The Holy Spirit may have already revealed it to you. But could it be your vice of temptation is anger? You just fly off the handle. Well, you know, that's my blood. You know, if you knew my father and if you knew my grandfather. Well, if you knew my heavenly father, that he cleans us up from the inside out, you can overcome that. Is it anger? Is it anxiety? Oh, what's going to happen? Oh, our president signing executive orders. Oh, what's going to happen? Oh, my goodness, can I look at some immigrant in the eyes without them thinking I'm thinking this and that? Oh, what's going to... Oh. We're just freaking out. Is your temptation... Maybe you haven't followed the Lord in believer's baptism. Maybe you're harboring bitterness. Maybe you're in that you get tempted with that comparison. And you're the family that when this family gets a new vehicle, it bothers you. You're not happy for them. You're like, how did they get a new car? Where I know where he works. How did he get the money for that? Oh, they must have had some relative give him money. And look what happened to you. Your lust hath consumed you, and it's getting you real close to sin. And be careful, because sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. You teenagers, man, I wish you could have those parents over there. They're pretty cool, man. Look at what they do with their kids. Blah, 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 blah. Comparison. Maybe it's the maybe you're tempted with contention. Contention. You walk in the auditorium. Well, let's go sit on the other side of the auditorium. I didn't think they would be here. Contention. Contentment. Maybe we're just okay. Been saved for a few decades. I'm not going to hell. I'm doing pretty good. God wants us to grow. How about our conversation? How about our deception? A division, enticing, envy, excuses, fear, feigning. Feigning is a Bible word for the put on. It comes from the Greek word where they used to wear the masks and perform and all that. And oh, I need to be happy, so they put the mask on and I'm happy today. Oh, I need to be sad, I need to put this mask on. And maybe that's you, that you always deal with that as you come to church, as you, good morning, brother. Good morning, sister. God bless you. Then you get out of the car, dirty ricker, 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 ricker. Maybe yours is feigning. Maybe yours is faithfulness. Maybe yours is judging others. Maybe the temptation is laziness, lying. Maybe it's materialism. We got to get the newest, latest, and greatest on the day it comes out. We can't wait 2 days. We can't wait a week. Good night. I can't even wait 3 years. I've got to get it now. Why? I get sick and tired every 2 years. I'm telling me to upgrade my cell phone. My phone's working great, except for that little sabotage thing that Apple does where they make your phone charger not work after, you know, 1 year and 11 months, so you have to get an upgrade. But really, I don't know. I like my phone. I'm a creature of habit. I hate when my computer updates new things on my computer. No, I like using my Microsoft Office the way it was. I got to learn this new again. No, I don't need the newest, the latest, greatest. I just like what's helping me now. Maybe we're materialistic. The tires on the car are working great, but you got to get bigger tires. The engine works well, but it's not loud enough, so we got to change this pipe underneath. And this is materialistic. Your kitchen was fine, ma'am, until that one lady you know remodeled hers. Those cabinets have been working great, but all of a sudden, you went to visit so-and-so and saw their kitchen. You don't remember what they talked about. All you remember are those new handles they got on their kitchen cabinets. And you're like, why doesn't Ralph get me new kitchen handles? Man, I'll tell you what. Materialistic. Obedience. Stubbornness. Selfishness. Service. On and on and on we can go. But maybe the Holy Spirit has just showed you already what it is that you're dealing with temptation. And only you know it. Are you separated from life? Remember, God said, I am come that you might have life and have life more abundantly. But when you succumb to temptation, when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, it bringeth forth death. I told our Sunday school class, sometimes I feel that when you preach to Christians, it's literally an episode of what they call the walking dead. These people come into church and they just, and they go to their pew and they sit right down. And Brother Roy says, take a psalm book. And they stand up and go, do I need a psalm book? Maybe he'll pick a song I know. And then he sings it. You go, good, I know that one. Then he does the forgotten third verse. You're like, watermelon cantaloupe, watermelon cantaloupe, blah, 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 blah. Oh, good, fourth verse. All right, then we just go through, okay, offering here, pass the plate. Oh, great, she's walking over here to give me the plate. Good, I don't have to get up. And then we go over, and we keep moving. Then we stand up, then we, in Jesus' name, amen, you're dismissed, and we just go back to our cars. Spiritually speaking, we're the walking dead. So remember, as we close this up, temptation is not from God. It does come to all of us. So because of that, be spiritually prepared. And allow this temptation to strengthen us, to draw us closer to God, to cleanse us for His service. Every head bowed, every eye closed. You've listened great. Though I do talk to a few people and counsel a few people in the week, nowhere near what our preacher does, I have found that most of the difficulties and obstacles that Christians deal with is within themselves. Some sort of inner demon, as they would say, but it's a temptation to become bitter, a temptation to not forgive, a temptation to constantly question, why, God, why? And just an anger and almost a shaking fist type mentality. It's the comparison, it's the materialism, it's this, it's that. Well, we never had this growing up, so I want to make sure my kids, and we go through all these things that only you and God know about. Well, why don't tonight be the night where you just overcome that with His help? With His help. Hey, sound the alarm every morning and say, I'm not going to let that temptation get the best of me anymore. And I'm going to bathe this thing in prayer. And I'm going to find verses in the Bible that deal with this particular topic so I can memorize them and help overcome this temptation because I want to live. I want to live. I mean, you'd say, Brother Clay, there is a temptation I'm dealing with, and I'd like you to pray for me. And by the uplifted hand, you'd say, Brother Clay, I want to get victory over this. Here it is right here. You'd say, pray for me, Brother Clay. God bless you. Good. God bless you.
Hello, Pastor White here. I want to thank you for tuning in to our live stream today. Whether you watched it live or on YouTube or maybe an archived sermon, thank you so much for taking the time to do so. And I want to conclude the message today by telling you a few things about how God feels about you and us in general. First of all, I want you to know today, if you're listening, God loves you. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. And that means you, friend. And so I want you to know today, God loves you. The second thing I want you to know is that all of us are sinners. We've all missed a mark. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We've all missed a mark, every one of us. The Bible also says in Romans chapter 5, verse 8, but God commended His love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And then in Romans 10:13, the Bible says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. I want to encourage you today, friend, there is hope for you. There's hope in the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you'd like to talk to someone about trusting Christ as your Savior, you can do so. You can reach us at the church here at area code 336-969-6937. Or you can reach us on our website at freedombaptistrh.com, where we'll have more information about salvation. And we'd love for you to let us know of your decision for Jesus Christ today. If you need prayer, if you need encouragement, please don't hesitate to call or email or visit our website, and we trust that you'll find the help needed in the Lord Jesus Christ. May you have a wonderful day, and may God bless you. Thank you again for listening to our broadcast.